I was hanging out with some people. Now I realize I shouldn't have.
The work was so hard. It was just going fast, fast, fast.
I got kicked out of school and nobody cared about me, so I don't care.
I sort of got messed up into gangs and other stuff.
School was very difficult.
I was expelled from school.
I mean, the one person who really got me to go back into school was my friend Kevin.
At my friend's graduation, I'm going to be the loudest one there.
Because if you don't have anybody while you're in school, then there's not really a way to get through it.
And I'm a member of Teens in Action. Welcome to our show. Next to me is our guest host for the show, Alex.
Hi, my name is Alex Knopper, and I'm a member of the Burbank Youth Board. Teens in Action is a show that's produced by teens for teens with topics that are important to us.
In this show, we are looking into how depression affects teens, what causes depression, how you recognize it, and where you can get help.
We want to know what you think, so we sent our Teens in Action reporters around the city to find out what teens know about depression.
Stress is an issue that every teen faces. Sometimes it's so overwhelming that they become depressed. What kind of issues lead teens to depression?
Like if you broke up with your boyfriend or girlfriend, that could lead to depression.
Probably family issues, like if their parents get divorced.
Parent issues mostly, and boy issues.
There's a lot of pressure to get good grades since of college and competition now. So like they might get depressed if they fail a class or something.
I think it's like stress mainly to get grades.
If someone's pressuring them to do something like drugs or something.
Feeling like you don't belong into your group.
The people that judge you a lot.
Mostly girlfriend problems.
Like boys issues.
I also think grades and college and to meet up to someone's expectation about yourself.
Some kind of deaf family or even friends.
People telling you what to do and what you should be. Like parents, they tell you what you should be. And if you're not like up to their expectations.
Their expectations are all like treating you like a pile of dirt, but yeah. That tends to happen.
What kind of things will indicate that someone's depressed?
Usually if they isolate themselves.
Most of the time, they're not themselves. They're kind of mopey.
Usually they ignore you and you could tell by their face, like their expressions, and like they don't participate in class or anything.
If they're down, they're usually not in a good mood.
If they're like unattached from you and they don't want to talk to you like they used to, and if they're not the way that you're so used to them being,
they isolate themselves. Like drastic changes which happen, or they look kind of gloomy, not themselves.
Express your feelings. Letting it out is better than keeping it all inside.
Everybody thinks I'm happy. They don't know, and I can't tell them what's really going on. I keep waiting for it to get better on its own.
I wish I could walk up to everybody who went through the same thing as I did.
Have you ever?
I just tell them, it's not your fault. It's not your fault.
No one ever tells you to just snap out of pneumonia. It's not because you're weak. It's because you're sick.
Misplaced your home behind, watching this world leaving you behind. Won't you give?
If you're having a hard time or know someone who is, call or log on for more information. 1-877-495-0009. Or visit www.nostigma.org.
Everyone has friends. There's online friends. Friends to go out with on a Saturday night. Friends to hang out with and do nothing. friends who show up on moving day. And then there are the friends who'll be there if someone is dealing with a mental illness. Are you one of those friends?
Welcome back to Teens in Action. It seems like we all have the same general causes of stress, whether it's grades, family, or friends.
You're right, Alex. As a teenager, we all experience these emotions. It's just a matter of finding the right resources to help us deal with them. Next, we talk to a high school student who tells us about a very difficult time in her life and how she got through it.
Susanna Tolkien is a 17-year-old student at one of the most academically challenging schools in the LA area. She also volunteers at the Teen Line at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center. Susanna has also been dealing with depression since she was in the fourth grade. She knew she felt different, but wasn't sure why.
Thank you, Susanna, for coming on our show today.
You're welcome.
You felt different at a very young age. Tell us what kinds of feelings you're having and what sort of symptoms.
I noticed when I was around, in fourth grade, I noticed that I was more sensitive than the rest of my classmates, and I cried more easily. I cried more in general. At sleepovers, I'd always have trouble sleeping, and I never thought anything was wrong since I never thought I was different. And then I started realizing more and more little things, more subtle things that other kids didn't have issues with. I was just a sadder kid, I guess.
Any specific symptoms?
I guess just developing insomnia, which I've still had to deal with, and I really did cry a lot, and it was kind of hard for me to make friends. Like, sometimes I'd be really outgoing, but usually I really was afraid of making friends.
Kids want to fit in at your school, like any other kids, our age. How did you try to hide your depression?
I faked smiles a lot for a really long time. I would just go around pretending that I was a lot happier than I really was. And actually, that ends up being a lot harder for most people, because the more you pretend, the worse it gets inside.
Mm-hmm. So, during your depression, during your symptoms of feeling depression, how did your family and friends react to it?
At first it was hard for my parents to take me seriously. Like, when you have a 12-year-old, 13-year-old, stuff like that, and your kid is moody, especially daughters, a lot of the time parents think she's crying, whatever, boy issues or something like that. And it was hard for them to take me seriously. It was hard for them to realize that maybe this was different than just the normal everyday mood thing. Once I really started opening up to them, they were a lot more receptive to what I had to say. It was harder with my friends. I actually did lose friendships when it got really bad, when the depression got really bad. It was hard for me to maintain normal relationships with some of my closest friends, and I really regret that. But it's hard for people to hear, if you're really depressed.
In your opinion, what was your lowest point during the depression?
Early 10th grade, I attempted suicide, and I had been self-injuring since 7th grade, and it just got really bad, and I felt like I didn't have anything to live for. I felt like my friends had left me. My parents still weren't, they weren't always at home there for me. And my grades weren't great. I hadn't been sleeping. I hadn't been paying attention in school. And I thought, what's the point? So, I tried to slit my wrists. And sort of while it was happening, I stopped and I sort of distanced myself from the situation, and I said, what are you doing? At that time, I was 15, and I thought, I have my whole life ahead of me. Why end it now? It has to get better. And from there, everything got really, really serious. And yeah, it sort of had to get worse before it got better. I was hospitalized for a while. but it's true that once you hit bottom, you can only go up, and I did. I entered really intensive therapy, which is what I needed. I found a great therapist. I started mending my friendships. I started being much more open with my feelings. And so, yeah, it was my lowest point, but it was also the best thing that could have happened to me, since it did lead to me getting so much better.
You mentioned earlier you stepped back and, you know, you looked at your life and, you know, you realized what was going on. What exactly made you think about what you were doing, like, and how, what made you think about your future?
I thought about what I wanted to do when I got older. I thought about what I could do. I thought about people that I knew who had suffered with depression, because I talked about this with older people that I knew, and it happens, and people go through it, and life is hard, but I just realized that I didn't want to die, and I wanted to see what was going to happen with the rest of my life.
There's therapy and there's medication, but what helped you the most deal with your sadness and with your grieving?
Both, really, a combination. I had to try two kinds of medication, and one of them made me nauseous and made it even harder for me to sleep, so I thought at first, oh, there's nothing that can help me. Until I found something that really worked for me, and I cried less, I slept better, I felt a little stronger, I felt like I was better prepared to face the world, and therapy. I had to do it, I think I was doing it 4 times a week for an hour and a half. It was a lot of therapy. And yeah, it took up a lot of my time, but I found a great therapist. I guess what worked the most was the therapy, and I needed the medication to get me through the hardest times.
We understand you have to deal with your depression every day. How do you deal with it now, currently, without your medication and therapy, and how do you help others?
Well, I still go to therapy sometimes when I'm having a really tough time, and yeah, I deal with it every day. Everyone feels sad. I do, you know, I still cry. I still get emotional. I'm still sensitive. I haven't changed, you know, it hasn't changed who I am, but I'm just better prepared. I can say, well, what made me feel this way? What made me start to feel so sad, or maybe made me start to cry? How can I avoid those situations? And also just accepting that regular sadness is a part of life. And I work for Teen Line now, and it's this teen-to-teen hotline, and it's just, you know, I answer the calls. So people call the line and I'll pick up the phone, and I never know what kind of call it's gonna be. And it's one of the best things that I could have done, because I'm helping people. And so my life is worth so much more, not just because I'm living for me, although I am, but also if I can help other people, it's an amazing feeling.
Okay, is there anything you'd like to add?
I just think that people, a lot of the time, are afraid to get help and think there's really something wrong with them, or that their friends will hate them, or just, you know, afraid to talk about depression, feeling suicidal. And people just need to know that it's so important to get help, and there really are people who can help, and there's always someone to talk to. So.
Thank you, Susanna, for coming.
You're
and
welcome.
For discussing, you know, your life story and how you felt in the past and how you can help others. And we really enjoyed having you here.
Thank you
very much.
Suicide is the third leading cause of death among people ages 15 to 24, killing over 5,000 each year.
We used to write letters to each other a lot, and it was intimidating talk to him sometimes because he just seemed so isolated by himself.
She started talking about how she wishes that her life was over and she wishes that she was never born.
So I knew he had depression, but I didn't know it was that far.
Said something to me about
killing himself.
Tell somebody, tell an adult, a counselor, parent, whatever.
You have to try and help them get help.
You have to take it seriously. You can't assume that they're just saying it because the risk is too great.
It's a hard situation because you do risk making that person very angry and losing their friendship.
It would have been horrible for me if she never talked to me again, but I'd live with it because I know she'd be alive.
Definitely worth getting help, even if you think you're going to lose a friendship, because it's better to lose the friendship than the actual friend.
Ready. 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 Ready.
It can be a little awkward when your friend tells you he's been diagnosed with a mental illness. But what's even more awkward is, if you're not there for him, he's less likely to recover.
I'm here to help, man, whatever it takes.
Welcome back to Teens in Action. I really liked how open and honest Susanna was about how hard it can be for kids to approach their parents and mend their friendships.
I thought it was very interesting when Susanna said that we have to have the courage to go through the trials before things can get better. In our next segment, we send reporters out to ask teens what they would do if they were depressed.
How can you help a friend who is depressed?
You basically talk to them and comfort them. You tell them like everything's all right, and you kind of go into stuff that you know about them and make them think about the good times.
You wouldn't want to put them down. You'd want to help them out.
Just cheer them up.
I'll probably tell them go get help from like school or somebody.
I get all the facts, you know, so I can like understand exactly what's wrong, because a lot of times there's a lot of gossip going around and you hear this and they say that, and I'd probably want to know exactly what went down and then like, you know, pretty much just figure out what the best solution is.
Every 100 minutes, another teen commits suicide.
I agree. The first thing to do is to talk to an adult you trust. It's also a good idea to get involved in clubs, sports, or other hobbies.
And if a friend wants to talk to you, the best thing to do is just listen. This next story is about a guy who at 25 uses his personal experience with mental illness to raise awareness and provide a positive example for young people nationwide.
In high school, Ross Szabo had the perfect life. He was junior class president, he played on the varsity basketball team, and was active as a volunteer. What everyone didn't know was that he only pretended to be happy. Inside, he wanted to die. Ross Szabo, director of youth outreach for the National Mental Health Awareness Campaign, recently graduated with honors and a Bachelor of Arts degree in psychology.
Thank you, Ross, for being here today.
Thanks a lot for having me.
Many depressed teens don't look or act sad. To your family and your friends, you seemed happy, but on the inside, your feelings were totally different. Why did you consider suicide?
Well, you know, you don't consider suicide right at the beginning. You know, a lot of times the buildup of having thoughts of loneliness and having thoughts of emptiness lead to thoughts of suicide. So for me, in around summer before my senior year, I started feeling different. I started feeling like I had these emotions that no one else had. And that led to me feeling lonely. So in the beginning of my senior year of high school, I was already feeling lonely. I felt like there was no one to talk to, no one would understand me. But even if there was someone to talk to, even if there, I felt there was someone that would understand me, I thought I should have to suck it up and deal with it on my own and get through it on my own. I didn't think that I could talk about what I was feeling. I didn't think I could talk about the emotions that I was having. So I always thought one day I'd wake up and that loneliness would go away. One day I'd wake up and I wouldn't feel lonely anymore. If I just dealt with it on my own, if I just got through it on my own, it would be okay. Well, the loneliness didn't go away. And in November of my senior year, I started having thoughts of death and suicide.
Many people think everyday stress is depression. What is depression and how do you recognize it?
Well, it is important to know, that's a good point, that there is a difference between sadness and depression. The biggest difference is a lot of times sadness is something that has an identifiable cause. So a lot of times young people go through hard times for the first time in their lives. Some may experience divorce, some may experience death, some may experience rejection, whether it's a breakup, whether it's friends stop talking, and whether it's, you know, bad grade in school. Some young people may experience other types of rejection or may see a pet die, anything like that. They can sit down to themselves and they can say, okay, why am I upset? I'm upset because this happened. Now, some of those events are so traumatic that they do need to seek help. Your parents get divorced, that's a big change. Someone you close to you dies, that's a big change. That's something that you really do need to talk about no matter what. You shouldn't be afraid to talk about that. But depression is something totally different. When you have depression, you don't always know what's wrong. You may feel like everything's wrong. Everything is against you, your whole world's bad. Now, if your whole world is bad, if your whole world is negative, you're gonna have a lot of anger inside of you. You're gonna have anger at yourself, you're gonna have anger at other people. One of the biggest signs of depression is having a lot of rage. And people don't always view that as a sign of depression. They think, well, how could these people be so angry if they're so sad? And other signs of depression are large outbursts of crying for no reason. You stop doing the things you enjoy, which doesn't always mean going to school. You know, that can mean stop hanging out with your friends, stop playing sports, things like that. You stop taking care of yourself. So you may stop bathing, you may stop eating, you may stop exercising, doing things like that. Anything you're experiencing is something you should talk about, but we do need to know that there's a big difference between sadness, which can happen to everyone on an everyday basis, and depression, which is a condition that can go on for periods of 3 weeks, months, even years in some people. Both should be talked about, both should be understood, but with depression, there needs to be a different level of how you treat it and how you get through it.
What are the warning signs that someone is going through depression?
The most prevalent warning sign, or the most common warning sign you're gonna see in young people, is they're gonna stop doing the things they enjoy. They're gonna stop caring about the things they care about. They may give some of their things away if they're really thinking about taking their own lives. They will, you know, want to lay in bed all day. They will want to shut down. They may act out anger against other people or act out anger against themselves. Sometimes one of the biggest signs of depression can be cutting yourself. There are other signs of depression. You know, eating disorders co-occur with depression a lot. So someone may have an eating disorder and depression. Alcohol and drugs are also big things with depression. A lot of times when you have all these depressive thoughts, you don't want to think like that. You don't want to feel like that. So you turn to alcohol to shut your mind down.
As a teenager myself, how can I help someone who's going through depression?
There's two things to be aware of when you want to help your friends that you think are experiencing depression. And the first thing is focusing on them. You want to note to them, or you let them know that you think they've changed their behavior. So, because a lot of times people aren't even aware that they are having a problem. So you can say, hey, you used to do this, and now you're doing this, and I feel like it's because you may have some type of problem. Or maybe, you know that something happened in your life. Maybe that death affected you that way. Maybe your parents getting divorced affected you that way. Once you help them identify the problem, then you want to let them know that no matter what they're going through, it is treatable. No matter what they're going through, it is something they can get through, especially if they're a teenager. They have about 60, 70, 80 years of their life left. They can make a choice to try and work through it and try and work on it now to make those rest of their life a little bit better. And you can help them by asking them questions and finding out what's going on.
Is there anything about depression or suicide you would like to add?
Well, I think the biggest thing that I try to promote is there is a way to get through it. So it's important to know that no matter what you're going through, you need to find what works best for you. You need to find what type of treatment or whatever you can do and what works best for you. And that can be different in every single person. So I try to leave young people with a positive message all the time that, you know, I know there may be bad days. I know there may be days that you don't think are gonna end or you don't think you can get through. But if you work on yourself and if you try and find what works best for you, and if you take the time to do it, it is something that you can change and it is something that you can get through. All these problems are treatable.
Thank you, Ross, for not only sharing your personal story with us, but furthermore informing us about depression and suicide.
You're welcome. Thanks a lot.
Don't ignore the warning signs of depression. It's okay to get help.
People want to believe you're okay, so it's easy to pretend you're okay.
I don't want advice. I just want to talk to somebody who gets it.
Have you ever worn thin
There's no way to explain what it feels like. You just want to stop, get off the ride.
Have you ever lost your belief? Watching your faith turn to grief.
Thing is, it does get better. Just believe that. You gotta believe that.
If you're having a hard time or know someone who is, call or log on for more information at 1-877-495-0009 or visit www.nostigma.org. Everyone has friends. There's online friends. Friends to go out with on a Saturday night. Friends to hang out with and do nothing. Friends who show up on moving day. And then there are the friends who'll be there if someone is dealing with a mental illness. Are you one of those friends?
Welcome back to Teens in Action. One of the best things to do when you're going through a hard time, according to Ross, is to talk to people you trust in order to express your feelings.
That's right, Jennifer. And when watching Ross, it's evident that you can't always know who is depressed. I like how he said, everyone gets sad, but depression is a condition that needs to be talked about. There are so many things that we are told to do. Call this number or ask for help. Some teens might not know what to expect, so we thought we would show you what it might be like if you decided to get help.
Hi, Teen Line.
What does Teen Line do? Like,
Teen Line is just a teen-to-teen talk line where other teenagers call in with any problems they're having, and we listen to them and try to help them with options. And
my boyfriend just broke up with me, like, last night, right? And in the worst possible way, he broke up with me over the internet.
I could definitely understand how this would frustrate you. Did you try to call him or contact him in any way after?
No. What do I do?
I mean, you could try calling him if you want, or you could email him back, or you could talk to him at school.
I don't even know if I should talk to him. I mean, he was such an idiot to tell me. I mean, obviously he doesn't see me for who I am. And for the whole year and a half that we've been going out, he hasn't seen me.
You don't want to talk to him at all? Just to get closure?
I guess it wouldn't hurt anything. I have to go to dinner. Is there a time that I can call you back? Or?
But if you can't call back tonight, you can call back tomorrow and someone else will be here, but they'll definitely talk to you.
Thank you so much.
Good luck.
Thank you. Bye.
Exercise can be an antidepressant. It makes you feel better.
It's nice to see what you should expect from a phone call if you really need someone to talk to.
You know, sometimes it's just easier to talk to a trained professional because they know how to talk to you. We had a lot of really important information in this show, but there's a lot of information on the web too. So grab a pen and paper and get ready to write down a few sites you might want to visit.
Depression can affect anybody. It affects your thoughts, feelings, behavior, and overall health. When a friend is going through a hard time, don't talk. Just listen. They need to talk more than you. 80 to 90% of people that seek treatment can function normally. Many teens feel they have no place to go for help. Teen Line is a place where teens are helping teens. We're here to help. Call 1-800-TLC-TEEN or 1-800-852-8336. Most people don't understand the warning signs of depression. To find more information, visit www.teenlineonline.org. nostigma.org, a website created by the National Mental Health Awareness Campaign. You can talk to a therapist from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. when you call 1-800-THERAPIST. For those who need immediate help, call and talk to a certified counselor at 1-800-SUICIDE, available 24/7.
Thank you for joining us. We hope this show gave you something to think about. Please know there's always someone you can talk to.
There are a lot of teens who put this show together. As the credits roll, you will see some of what the members of Teens in Action did behind the scenes to create this show.
See you next time on Teens in Action.
Adios.
There's no way to explain what it feels like.
People want to believe you're okay, so it's easy to pretend you're okay.
It's not because you're weak. It's because you're sick.
Everybody thinks I'm happy.
It's not your fault.
Thing is, it does get better.
If you're having a hard time or know someone who is, call or log on for more information. 1-877-495-0009 or visit www.nostigma.org.